the mind of a rapper or even a poet and the mind of a comedian is so very parallel. The content of any hip hop song or even a comedian, we're talking about the same stuff. The delivery is different. Hey man, it's a guy named MC Kane, right? That I've been knowing for years before he was MC Kane. You know, and I used to just go, I was like, you know, watch a sitcom, and it's like the wacky next door neighbor come in. That was me, because he lived right by my mother's place. So I come in, I'm eating all the food, I knew his family, I knew everybody, you know. And we talking about MC Kane, we talking about the dude that's tied in to every aspect of Houston nightlife. The rappers, the waitresses, the club owners, the managers, whoever. So he started a Monday night room called Aztecas, right? He approaches me one night and says, hey, I got this thing I'm doing on Mondays. What are you doing on Mondays? I'm like, you know, I'm not doing nothing. You know, so I want you to host it. You know, never hosted nothing before. He's never seen me host because I never done anything. You know, but he just knew me as being the funny guy that was around his family all the time and just would just say stuff, you know, from the left field, just out, you know, from the top of my head. So boom, just without seeing me, without ever seeing any of my stand-up, seeing me host anything, boom, put me right in and basically spoon-fed me an audience. So here I am, young Ken Boyd, in front of all these drunk-ass people. You got language on here?
No.
Okay.
YouTube.
Okay, in front of these drunk-ass people, right? Young college kids, around college kids age, drunk off their ass on the margarita swaggeritas, if he was in there, you know? And I have to control these people. So, and I later discovered the who's who in the city would be coming. You could look out in the crowd and see J-Mac from 979. You could look out in the crowd and see Kurt Cobain. You see Jess Brittany. You see Propane. You see D-Lo. You see all these guys. And here I am in front of all these people. And I'm being exposed to these who's who of people. And this guy comes up to me, little dark, ugly nigga. With a big ass gap in his mouth. And says, yo man, you know, you was funny, man. You know, I got this thing I'm doing on my next project. I want you to come and, you know, do some sketches or whatever. That guy's name was Dante Higgins. I'm listening to his music, like, yo, this dude is nice. And so then I got excited to work with him. And the project came out so dope, you know, because the sketches I was doing met with his content so perfectly. It was just like, it was an instant click. So now, you got the D-Lo's listening to his music, you got the Propane's listening to the music, you got whoever in that elite hip-hop Houston community listening to this music that I'm on. So now, I'm getting an invite from this rapper or this hip-hop, like, hey, I heard what you did on Dante Higgins, can you come and do something for me? Oh, I heard what you did on that, can you come? And then, like wildfire, man. From there, I did a sketch with DeLorean D-Lo on the Grace project. And it was so dope about him, you know, he approached me and said, hey, I don't want you to be funny. You know, I just want you to give your thoughts and your opinions about the concept of grace. So I'm on there just talking, I'm being completely serious, and I was out of my comfort zone. Now here's a funny story. I actually got invited to do a sketch for Propane. And so I got a lot of information on Propane, just being prepared, you know, to do a good sketch. I find out what his real name is and all this stuff, and just a little history. And the project was called Riding Slab. What's the overall theme of the project? And he's like, well, you know, a slab, you have to put it together, and it's components to a slab, the paint and the rims, and just like my career, you know, I'm constantly building myself. So I'm like, okay. So boom, I go in, and I'm just like, okay, what do you want me to do? Just do you. You might be talking about me a little bit. Bet, cool. Say no more. So I go in the booth and I'm saying this ridiculous stuff about Propane.
What you saying?
I'm saying stuff like, man, hey, yeah, Propane, man. You know, I remember back in the day when he wasn't Propane, man. He used to be in a church choir, man. He had a voice like an angel, man. Everybody knew about You know what I'm saying? I remember back in the day he had these little spots on the back of his neck. You know, everybody used to call him Spotty Pippin. Back in the day, back in the 90s, man. And I remember Pro before he came, he wanna shine on me now, but now I knew him back in the day, you know what I'm saying, before now he riding slab. You know, back in the day he was riding cab. But you know what's funny? Never made the album.
It didn't?
Never made the album.
He never told me, but I think I executed the sketch a little too well. Maybe. Any crowd is gonna dissect you as soon as you get on stage.
Right,
you know, and then so, but how much wisdom does this particular crowd have that's a little older? You know, that's late 40s, early 50s, late 50s, you know, what have you. So, you know, just from that alone, they can tell, like, come on, man, what are you talking about, something that you don't know nothing about?
So basically, in terms of appearance or image, if it doesn't necessarily align with your material, sometimes it could kind of go
Yeah, wrong. Most definitely.
Do you ever see an instance where your image may not really tell a true story of your personal story?
Yeah.
It's not resonating just because of the way you look.
Yeah, well, you know, me, I love to dress on stage. Yeah, I love to dress in general. I love to put an outfit together. That's just who I am, and I just carry it over on stage. So when I come on stage, you'll see me with a nice button down on, a nice jacket. You might see me with a tie, bow tie, what have you, maybe a vest, slacks, maybe some jeans, a nice belt, my shoes, I'm gonna have some type of crazy socks on or something like that. But you know, it's gonna be well put together. And then so as soon as I step on stage, maybe the dudes might be, oh, okay, who's this pretty boy? This pretty ass nigga, who the fuck is this? But then when I begin to speak, and when I'm speaking about the things that resonate to a dude that's from a particular neighborhood, then they say, oh, it's shy. It's like, oh, what you know about that? Because I'm from the same neighborhood. I'm from the same area. I just like to dress. I've dedicated very little thought to this. But I've noticed it, but it was a question on my mind. I was like, yeah, why is that? And then I just went on about my business. Like, I noticed, like, hey, I noticed it's not a lot of women. Oh, okay.
It's obvious when a woman is funny, they're funny. Mm-hmm. I don't say women aren't funny, but if you can run them down, they are funny. It's not as many. So I was kind of curious.
The absolute funniest comedy show that I've been to live. Oh, no, let me change that. The funniest live performance that I've seen came from a woman named Coco Brown. And I'm talking, I'm just, if you know anything about comedy, you know what a closing bit is.
Mm-hmm, the strongest.
Right? Now, you know, to the civilians, a bit is a joke. It's a little bit in a whole set of material, right? So a closing joke is your strongest joke. This is gonna bring the house down. And generally, you wanna save that to the end, right? This woman had about 8 closing jokes. 8 jokes that were closing worthy, back to back. Boom! Go to the next one. Boom! Number 3. Boom! Number 4. Boom! And I'm on the side like, what in the hell?
Did you have to follow her or did you?
No, actually, she followed me.
Oh, thank goodness.
Yes.
Well, I'm not down to
scale. Yeah, I was all right. As a matter of fact, I take my DVD that night. My first DVD, Mama Raised the Food.
But sometimes that can attribute who went before, you know, sometimes you got the crowd.
Perhaps. Yeah. But man, I'm telling you, it was just a sight to see. I'm talking the entire crowd. Bam! You could see the jokes hit. You could see the wave of the effect and the laughs, just the ripple in the crowd. And everybody, oh, I'm like, God. I like to look at the crowd when a comic is on stage to see the response. If somebody, bam, bam, you can see it. Wow. Hey, back to back. Bam, bam. So there's plenty of them, man, but my humble opinion is I think maybe a lot of women may be a little self-conscious. Well, you know, just me speaking, I grew up around women, and these are the most insecure people on the, not people, but creatures on the planet. Even about things that they don't have to be, there's no reason for them to be insecure about. Oh, my face, my weight, my hair, blah, blah, blah. And we look at them and say, what are you talking about? You, what are you saying? You look fine. You look gorgeous. I'm attracted to you. But no, my hair, my toenail, what are you saying? So I think when it comes to getting on a big stage in front of a lot of people, all your insecurities are
enhanced
or there's magnified.
But I think what you're saying is evident in that episode of Mic Check with Donnie Houston.
Yeah,
Being out of your element because you're not an MC, you're a comic.
Of course.
But when you look at it, it's extremely entertaining. He must have thought so too because he posted it and he published that.
Man, that was just so organic, man. I was over there and I saw my man, Critical, with his shirt off. You know, going by the real name now, Rob Gallet.
I done dropped the tape, about to lock the state.
I'm sick as fuck, can't nobody operate. Body rock and shake, boys know I'm out the H. No days off, motherfucker holiday.
Gillette, whatever his name is. And he just shirt off, sweating, rapping his ass off. I'm like, what you doing? And Don's like, yo, this is my little thing I got going on, mic check. I'm like, yo, can I get one? I don't mind asking, yo, can I do it? I'm like a child when it comes to entertainment. Like, I get excited. Can I do it? I want to do one. I'm like his nephew or something. He's like an uncle. He's like, yeah, whatever. Yeah, go and let the little nigga get one in. So he's like, what beat you want? And that's when You Don't Even Know It first came out. I was like, give me that, give me that. And I told him, I said, start at my feet and then pan up, and after that, I'm a rap. And I was like, what you gonna say? I don't know. And then so I hit a and I was like, yo, and I just started saying ridiculous shit.
They ain't even know it. They ain't even know it. I'm rapping now. They ain't even know it. I'm trapping now. They ain't even know it. Got an STD. I'm clapping now. They ain't even know it.
Yo, that was fun. I watch it every now and then. I pull it up like, yo, look at this ridiculous ass shit, man.
But just knowing that you developed a strong following here in Houston and you decided to, you know, to pack up shop, move out to Harlem, what made you do that?
Hey man, low ceiling, you know? You gotta go where the industry is. Gotta go where the Jews at, man. Ain't no Jews around here, nigga.
Right place.
You gotta go where the Goldsteins at, baby. And then, you know, on the other side, it's like, okay, well, I remember when I first started doing stand-up and I was just going around watching the comedian. I used to just see these phenomenal comics that's still here. And I used to watch them like, yo, why is this dude not on TV or in some movie or why he ain't Hollywood? Yo, I'm talking just go up and just do it, man. Just material off the dome, crowd, crowd work, you know, just delivery just unparalleled. I'm like, yo, you know, but they never left, you know. And then, you know, the best example I've heard is from a guy named Carlos Wallace. He said, you can be the best basketball player in the park, but at the end of the day, you are still in that park, in that hood, and you're not putting yourself in a position where the scouts can see you.
How did that relationship come about?
Met him at Aztecas.
Ah, indeed. So it comes back around.
MC Kane. That's why I will forever, forever say MC Kane is my man. 100 grand. If he calls me right, I ain't got no shoes. There you go. Because look at the
trajectory he put you on.
The chain reaction, man. This and then this happening and that happening. Boom, boom. And I can track that back to this one individual moment when he said, hey man, what you be doing on Mondays? From there.
What's the next midterm, long-term goal for you?
Man, I've gotten several confirmations that on film is where I need to be. Like maybe 4 weeks in a row, someone said that to me. Like, yo, I want to see you in this because you got a thing that I think would translate well. I'm like, okay, so there's one next week. Somebody else said next week. So my mind is slowly gearing towards, you know, everything dealing with film, whether it be commercials, whether it be sitcoms, whether it be in a movie. You know, so I'm actively gearing towards that. You know, getting with an agency. You know, official representation. That's where my mind is going now.
But Ken, I would like to thank you for coming out, sitting down, doing an interview. It means a lot for Khntxt. Just want to say thank you.
You're welcome. And you're lucky to have me.
You gotta do this.
Yo, 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 this is Mr. Ken Boyd, and you're watching Khntxt TV with Corey Terry. You dig?